Dr. Dikshita Ajwani, sorry for inconvenience. That was a technical fault. Hope now all things will be fine. It is my great pleasure to welcome all of you in this 5 days webinar series organized by Department of History and Civilization, Gautam Buddha University, Greater Noida. The theme of this 5-day webinar series is Various Dimensions of History in Perspective of Medieval Period. In this series, today I am inviting Honorable VC Dr. Narendra Singh Rathod sir to share his expert thoughts on education. Honorable VC Dr. Narendra Singh Rathod sir is a well-known name in the field of education and does not require any introduction. At present, Dr. Rathod sir is holding the post of Vice Chancellor, Maharana Pratap University of Agriculture and Technology. Before that, he worked on very prestigious and important positions, which includes Deputy Director, General Education, ICAR, Founder, Vice Chancellor, SKNAU, Jobnair, Deputy Director, General Engineering, Dean, College of Dairy and Food Science Technology, Dean, Student Welfare, Dean, College of Technology and Engineering, in MPUAT Udaipur, HOD in CTAE, PIAICRP on renewable energy and project coordinator, TBUIC and RBTC, National Director in World Bank sponsored. In addition to, he also been discharging the duty of Vice Chancellor of MLSU Udaipur. Besides this, he is also honored with 33 prestigious awards and fellowships, which includes Young Scientist, Outstanding Book, Outstanding Services, ISAE Commendation and Team Hindi Research Papers, World Bank IDM Best Teacher, Energy Conservation, National Technology Day, Global Dairy Innovation, Marwad Ratan, Dr. K.K. Lia Memorial Oration Award, Vijaya Bank Endowment Award, and Lifetime Achievement Award from SEE and SURE. He has also 33 books and many valuable research papers in national and international journals. Along with that, he is also a member of various important committees and organizations. So now I take this opportunity to request Honorable VC Rathod sir.
Good afternoon. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for giving me this platform. Madam Dikshita, thank you very much for nice introduction. I'm sorry that at 3 o'clock I could not join because of some technical problem. And this problem we will have to remain now onward as well, because now as far as the education is concerned, probably online education and e-learning will be most feasible and everybody will be dependent on this. So we will have to identify right platform where we can speak in a right way. So thank you very much for giving this opportunity. Today, as far as my topic of discussion is concerned, I would like to discuss as far as the education, past, present and future. These are the three words which I am purposely keeping these three words. Past means during medieval period. Let us see what exactly happening at this moment. What was the basic fundamental behind education? For what purpose education was meant? What is the present scenario as far as the education is concerned? And what will be the future scenario? Future means when we are thinking that world has already been changed, in case if this changed world will be forever, then what will be the scenario of education? But in fact, education means when you see its definition, E-D-U-C-A-T-I-U-N, education means it is equipping and disseminating unique collection and technology in open and network mode. That is a basically education in present context. And you kindly see that education is not only meant to create a right type of awareness on a particular subject, but but at the same time it is meant to awaken the policy maker. Education is not only limited to make us more wisdom on a particular task, just to create awareness, but at the same time we are also responsible. If we are educated, then we are also responsible to create a right type of a let us awaken the policy maker on a particular subject matter. Education is also meant for broadening our scope of work and bridging the gap between demand and supply. And in fact, as a philosophically, I can say education means it is essentially meant for broadening the different or bridging the gap between your wisdom and knowledge. That is a basically education. At the same time, education explore the different possibility of collaboration, cooperation, coordination. That is a basically inbuilt characteristics of education. Education is also meant for documentation of things and for disseminating the things to our different stakeholder. So there are a lot of advantages of education. And if we see from during medieval period, this period basically started, you all are history people, you will understand that from 10th of century to 18th of century, before British came into India, that particular period is a medieval period. And during this period, constant Muslim rural was there. And as such, I can say, don't take it otherwise, most of the Muslim rural, they were not having any interest in education, except Akbar. Akbar has done some good work as far as the education is concerned. Otherwise, most of the Muslim leader, they were not interested and they were limited. Their scope of education was limited to religion, a religion-dominated study only. They were more interested in expanding their religion. That was a basically things. And I can say that strictly they were orthodox in nature. I am using this word because as we basically, whatever things are available in documents, history, accordingly we can predict that they were more orthodox in this nature. And education in this period was not so impressive. And even what was a basic objective of education, it was not articulated in the mindset of a general masses. And at that time, if you see that there was a two system of education. One was a Muslim system of education and second was a Hindu system of education. Muslim system of education, as I narrated, that it was developing love for Muslim only. Muslim culture, Muslim religion. That was a one single point agenda behind the Muslim system of education. And they were enabling the individual for Islamic life. That was a basically, I can say that we should understand, we should see what is there in the different thing in our, in a different religion. At present, if you see, we have got a 28 state and 9 union territory. And if you see, we have got a 6 religion group and 6 ethnic groups and 6 different religion. If you see different type of languages, more than 2,117 languages there. Languages and dialectics is in our country. More than 4,200 caste and things are available. Everybody has got a different type of a caste system. Even within Brahmins, lot of Brahmins is there. Within Rajput, lot of Rajput is there. Their classification there. A lot of things are there. That's why it is not a, may say, objectionable that we should not understand what is Islam, culture and religion. One should understand, but one should not be so biased to say that only education should be meant to love the Muslim culture and religion. That perhaps was a one of the drawback during this one. And individually, this particular Muslim system of education, it was meant only enabling the individual for Islamic life. That was a perhaps is not a required at this moment. And even I have gone through the history that they were responsible for preparing the student for the next world, and that world will be what they were predicting, that it will be full of Muslim only. That's why everybody, every student, teacher, they were moving in the same direction. But however, Hindu system of education at that time, it was having a deep interest in upliftment and advancement of early society and overall development. And as far as the rural development is concerned, perhaps this particular word came during this medieval period because of Hindu system of education, because in a Hindu system of education, because of poverty, everybody, every teachers and every person responsible for this education, he was interested to uplift their society, even overall development. And even they were more responsible to create awareness about advancement and frontier area of a development. That was a basically beauty of that Hindu religion or Hindu system of education. And during this period, all literacy sources were Vedas. You know that all important Vedas are responsible for our development. And in fact, our wisdom is only because of Vedas. We all Hindu, if you see our senior citizen or all persons, those who are representing our Hindu philosophy, they were a good orator of Vedas, and Hindu texts and script were more popular. And they were basically most of the Hindu texts and script, it was responsible to create a right type of awareness, means how we can have physical education, how you can have an intelligent education, how you can have an emotional education, how you can have a spiritual education. So that's why during Hindu system of education, there was a lot of good thing is there, but only thing which I could gather out of the history, that lack of state support, state were not supportive to the Hindu system of education, and religion oriented education, especially Islamic, it was dominating. And of course, through our ancestors, Hindu system of education, to certain extent, they have started Pathshala type of elementary education. And during this period, interesting thing was that no regular fees was charged, and everybody was responsible to create awareness. And even in Gurukul, if you see philosophy of Gurukul, it is a fantastic philosophy where residential accommodation is there. Students, they are supposed to remain inside of school only, and where education was having four important components. Very first important component is a physical education. Physical education gives an impression that physically how you can develop yourself, how you can have your impressive body language. Means, and it includes, again physical education include four important part. First is a food. Second is exercise. Third is a rest. Fourth is a leisure time. So basically, in a physical education, it was important during that time that every students were informed that what to food, how much to food, at what time one has to food, take a food. That was a concept, and which particular food is a nutritious, and how they can have during the age of 5 years, what type of food is recommended during the age of 10 years, 15 years, or when you are fully young at 21 years or more than 20 up to 25 years. Food, especially during physical education and a Hindu system of education, food was one of the important component which was included in to boost of a physical education. Similarly, what type of exercise is recommended? It is generally recommended during the residential educational system that everybody should perform some workout. And he should be in position to do some exercise. So what type of exercise is recommended for school going, up to 10 year of a student or 15 year of a student, accordingly at what time you are supposed to take rest, and even leisure time. In a physical education, a certain leisure time is given. Without any work, you are supposed to keep yourself busy. That is a leisure time. That was an interesting thing. Nowadays, nobody wants to come up for leisure time. Everyone is so much of a busy. So that's why one of the concept inside of your Hindu system of education. Second concept was intelligent education. And during this period, all intelligent education means learning something more as compared to what you have learned yesterday. Say example, if you are on today, if you want to learn something, let us see what you have learned yesterday and what is a new thing. Every day you will have to learn something. And in fact, teaching learning, this concept came through our Hindu system of education. Teaching learning means a learning teaching or teaching learning, if you see, it has got both the component. Even teacher is supposed to learn and then he is supposed to teach. Same thing is true with a student. They are supposed to take the learning lesson, and at the same time, they should be they should prepare themselves to become a master of the subject. So that's why teaching learning concept, it was a part of intelligent education, and basic concept behind this intelligent education is that every day you should learn something. And there was an English proverb which is coming in my mind, and I would like to narrate here, that a basic concept behind intelligent education is that a intelligent person of yesterday, if he will stop learning today, he will become uneducated tomorrow. That is a basic concept and philosophy behind the intelligent education, where every day you will have to do something extra. Every day you will have to learn something extra. The third education, which was more popular during the Hindu system of education, that was a emotional education. Emotional education means you should be emotionally involved in your system. It is not that, say example, you should understand each other, understand the philosophy and well-beings of other, and then you kindly interact with the other things. Basically, there is one more English proverb is there, that relationship will not depends upon how you will understand with each other, but relationship will depends upon how you will avoid misunderstanding between each other. So that's why emotional education means you should be away from the anger. I have seen many times students, they are agitating for a particular purpose in present context. But earlier during the medieval period, when their Hindu system of education and Gurukul and other things was there, even in the Pathshala, there was no scope of this type of agitation. Neither teachers were creating any, they were exciting on the student, and nor student can raise anything objectionable in front of a student. That was a beauty of education at that moment. And fourth education, which was more dominating Hindu system of education, was a spiritual education. Spiritual education means you should have a civic sense in your mind, and you should help others, and you should understand joy of giving. It is not always joy of taking, but it is a joy of giving. If you have got something to distribute, kindly distribute equally to each and everyone. And education, if you will start distributing, then it will be, you can say that it will be added exponentially. So that's why in spiritual education, I can give the example. Say example, one teacher is there. He is a good teacher, but in case he is a teaching, and most of the times taking tuition fees for teaching purpose, then he may not be having a right type of civic sense for expanding the education field, and therefore he is taking this type of a fees or salary. But a person, a teacher, who is teaching to a number of students without any added advantage and this hidden charges, then you can say that spiritually the second person who is not charging anything, he will be more good educationist in the field. So basically, combining this all thing, one can say that in past, as far as the success is concerned, success was combination of a education, it along with the enduring, along with the engrossing, and along with the emotional. As a result of these all four words, there must be something which should be sustainable in nature. It should have some interest as well. That's why I have used the word of enduring and engrossing. And it should have something relation to emotion. If you combine all these things in a medieval period, these all four points, educative, enduring and engrossing and emotional, was a responsible to make a person success. But in present context, whole thing has been changed. Now what is happening? Now we are responsible to create a right type of awareness in the mindset of a student, but our more responsibility is to create a right type of employment along with either through a government job or through entrepreneurship. Even we are talking that our students should become a job provider rather than job seeker. So in a present context, as far as the success is concerned, it is a combination of three words. First is education, which includes knowledge, skill, ability, and experiences. And all four words, when combined, it will become basically it is known as education. Knowledge means what to do, skill means how to do, ability means how to make a system simple and convenient, and experience means how to analyze your, how to reduce your losses and increase your efficiency. So in a present context, all education includes a combination of these all four words, knowledge, skill, ability, and experience. along with the employment and along with the entrepreneurship, that is a key role, playing a key important key role in as far as the present education is concerned. But as far as the future education is concerned, here I would like to mention that when everybody is thinking that world has changed, and in case if world has changed forever, then we will have to see what type of education will prevail. And in this case, of course, online education and e-learning mode will be more responsible. That's why two words are coming as far as the getting success is concerned. Very first word is a quick learning, and second word is a forced entrepreneurship. Everybody will be responsible for quick learning. Nobody will be so much of interested to get a degree in the form of a paper, but they will be more interested to gain a type of a knowledge and type of a skill, or they will try to start an entrepreneurship. So basically, quick learning means immediately within a span of, instead of having a in a traditional course, instead of having a one complete year or in a semester size, having a 6 month period, everybody will go for quick learning and a forced entrepreneurship. Because when we are talking about a rural economy or self-sustained economy, whereas forced entrepreneurship will come into the picture. So in future, this will be scenario. Let us see what is happening at that moment during the medieval period. It was not that there was no good university. Even Oxford University, it was a first medieval university in the 11th century, it was established. And you know, the standard of Oxford University, still it is within a first five university across the world. Same thing is true with the Cambridge University. It was established in the 13th of century. But interesting thing is that they are also standing high as far as our ranking of Cambridge University as an international platform is concerned. And interesting thing is that Cambridge University, they have decided, whatever may be the scenario in the post-corona period, they have decided that they will be having online education by September 2021. And this will be additionally burden to the student. The student, those who will join Cambridge University, they will have to spend more than that of 8.6 lakhs rupees per annum extra in order to equipped with respect to the online education. So basically, you can see that a medieval university, those who are pioneer as far as this initial inception is concerned, they still maintaining the same type of standard. Even they have adopted a new version of our education system, because everybody is aware that in future, as far as the post-corona period is concerned, we will be having this type of online education. In 1947, I would like to narrate some of the things, that in 1947, there were hardly of 30 universities. Even Nalanda and many good university was there, and 700 colleges were there, and only 4 lakh students were studying. At that moment, we were having a 33 crore population. In fact, before 1947, 39 crore were there, 3 crore went to Pakistan, and 3 crore went to your Bangladesh, and we were at 33 crore. Out of this 33 crore, only 4 lakh students were having an opportunity to join college and university. And at that time, there was no question of accreditation. As far as quality assurance is concerned, nobody was bothered. And out of 30 universities and 700 colleges, they were responsible to impart the education. No. And even there was no question of ranking. I have not seen anywhere. And there was no question of quality reform and assurance. And even then, they were fighting with a lot of problems. Same scenario was there. Still, at this moment, when we are having a 1,000 university and more than 40,000 colleges, even we have got a lot of problem. We are fighting with a lot of problem. Even we have got a somewhat frustration if you'll see what is happening with the developed country universities. And even then, in spite of fact that we are fighting with problem, having a frustration in our mindset, and even then we are responsible for focusing on quality. That is a basically things. Out of 1,000 university at present in our country, out of this one, we have got a central university, state-funded university, we have got a private university, we have got a deemed-to-be universities. And as a result of this, you will not believe that a 600 university out of 1,000 universities are non-accredited. out of 40,000 universities, more than 40,000 colleges, sorry, more than 25,000 colleges are non-accredited. Although we are, at this moment, we are enrolling a more than that of a 3.9 crore population. But if you see what is our population means a 37% of our population, 57% of our population is below 35 year of our age. And that constitute around 75 crore population. 75 crore population of our country out of 137 crore, they are in need of education, they are in need of some employment. And before COVID, International Monetary Fund has given a statistics that around 30% of our youth is having inequity. Inequity means they were not having any exposure for education, they were not having anything for their livelihood. That was a really alarming at this situation. But in other sense, if you'll see that 3.9 crore students are studying, and you must be knowing that the population of Canada is also around 3.9 crore. So we have got a network which can easily give education to whole of Canada. But unfortunately, we are not in position to complete this task for our country. And as such, if you'll see that we have got around 14 lakh of our teachers and those who are responsible for this job. There are a lot of issues is there as far as the different aspect of higher education is concerned. For your information, I would like to narrate. There are five important aspect is a governance at university level and governance at the college level. Governance means an institutional framework, means how systems is working, vice chancellor, registrar, deans, head of the department. This is an institutional framework. And then accordingly, in a governance itself, we should be responsible to take a timely action. We should maintain all procedure which will be a trouble-free. And at the same time, we should maintain a right type of a transparency. That is basically a generally need out of a right governance. In fact, we are in need of a strengthening governance and leadership in our university setup. That is perhaps one of the point where we should deliberate and see that how we can strengthen our governance and leadership. At the same time, second aspect which is important in higher education is a quality assurance. For every course, there must be a fixed syllabus. We should have a uniformity as far as the course syllabus is concerned across our country. In all 28 states and nine union territory, wherever may be the college, BSc or BCom and BA course, it should have a same type of course syllabus. It should have a same type of teaching learning. It should have a same type of evaluation. When we are talking about a 2T mechanism, teaching and testing, it should be uniform. Teaching and teaching learning process, every university, every college, whether your college in at rural area, semi-urban and urban, or even a frontier area of institute like IIT and IIM and Central University, everywhere there must be of the same type of education pattern. That is a second quality and second aspect which is a need of our as far as the higher education is concerned. Third point, which is a important aspect in higher education, that is a competency of faculty member. Although everywhere there is a faculty shortage, even you must be knowing that in a present condition, MHRD and UGC started a new movement and they are insisting that we should reduce the faculty or we should mitigate the faculty shortage. How we can do this, something will come out very soon. But in fact, we should have a committed faculty member or competent, as far as their competency is concerned, as per the requirement of a course, the teacher should fully equipped. He should be aware as far as the what he is supposed to teach and in what direction the student should gain a knowledge, so that not only the traditionally he should be in position to teach the student, but what is the present state of art of technology in present condition, and how you can increase the talent of a student, and how you can federate into the business group, which is one of the important thing. So basically, important thing is that we are supposed to articulate this 4T: traditional, technology, talent, and trading. And that's why a competent faculty member is a requirement of the day. And fourth aspect of higher education is a talented student. We should explore the possibility that we should be in the position to increase the talent of the student. There are a lot of innovative idea is there in the mindset of student. It's, we should be always proactively work, and we should promote innovation and entrepreneurship. And that should be the, our criteria. That is the fourth aspect, which is very important. And fifth aspect is that every higher education institute, it should be equipped as far as the infrastructure facility is concerned. It is not that you can start a university in a two-room building or three-room building, but at least of a physical structure or teaching learning equipments, even a technology-enabled learning system you should have, and at the same time, you should have all type of a digital solution. Nowadays, you must be knowing that a augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality, and extended reality, these are the something which can be incorporated in a, into the your in a virtual labs. So basically, you should have a right type of infrastructure facility. That is a basically need of our. But we are also supposed to understand what is the difference between formal education, non-formal education, and informal education. And accordingly, we will have to decide it that in a formal education, whenever we are talking, it is a generally at the school and college, it's structured type of education is there, which is in a pre-arranged in a right way. And learning is also evaluated through teaching, through certain type of examination. That perhaps we are missing it. And this is compulsory in nature. And it should be sequential as well. At present, what is happening is I am at present heading to university, but I have seen most of our students, they are also not fully acquainted with the COVID-19 situation. As a result of this, these people are not also happy. We are supposed to keep their interest in our mind as well, but we should keep, this is a formal education, which will be either through online or offline, we will have to carry out. But at the same time, since it is a structured education, you will have to evaluate it, and evaluation should be through examination. It may be of online examination and offline examination, depending upon the situation. But since it's a sequential education and usually pre-arranged, you kindly see that you will have to appear in the examination as well. But in case if it would have been in a non-formal and informal education, where there is no out of school, you can have everywhere, you can do this type of exercise. It is non-formal to certain extent, it is a structure. But as far as the informal education is concerned, it is unstructured, where there is a voluntarily, you can join and you cannot join. But even then, learning is not evaluated. So that is a different issue. But in present condition, if some student has joined, or all teachers, this is my appeal to all teachers, kindly make it clear in the mindset of our student, since it is a formal education, we will have to evaluate. But in future, it is also expecting that, as I have given the example of Cambridge University, that they have decided they will be having online education up to September 2021. Same thing may be true for our country as well, in case if corona will be worst in near future. And at that moment, there are a lot of online platforms is available. You must be knowing MOOC. MOOC means a open, that is a massive open online courses is there. There are a lot of courses is there. Basic fundamental behind MOOC or ProCool. There is also one of the education system, ProCool. ProCool means a P-R-O-C-O-O-L, promoting cooperative learning. Means a anyone can participate, anytime he can participate, anywhere he can join. Means each and everything is mounted on, or it is a technology and enabled learning system which is mounted on your mobile or smartphone or even on your laptop. So you can have this type of arrangement. So in future, maybe having that we may have this type of online education and other things. But at this moment, as far as the way forward in education is concerned, as I have narrated, there is a need to strengthen our governance and leadership. Even there is a need to improve our quality that perhaps we are missing. And as a result, I remember still many foreign country, they are accrediting our university. Either you are from IIT or IIM, even then, if you are going abroad, you will have to accredit your university and college based on your what you are imparting. So that's why, in spite of fact that a government of India is a signatory on a Washington Accord, and as such, we have started a NAC and other accreditation body. But even then, we are supposed to strengthen our governance and we are supposed to increase our quality. And at the same time, an important task is there. We will have to mitigate faculty shortage. And there is a need. I can see and I can really, I am happy that a lot of teachers has joined this this webinar. So basically, there is a need in present context. Let us link all inspired teachers and let us build a network having a all inspired teachers in a different subject so that we can reduce inbreeding. And there is a major problem of a inbreeding in most of the institutes. So we will have to break this inbreeding in case if we are really responsible for quality assurance. And we should emphasize on research as well. It is not like that our job is for teaching job. We should have a teaching, research, technology outreach, capacity building, training, consultancy, testing, certification. There are a lot of issues is there. And unfortunate part is there in traditional education system, only teaching, nothing else. So basically, we will have to see, we will have to emphasize on research, and we will have to have a social relevance as well. Society, how you are connected with society, even every scientist should have a societal contact. Scientist, social responsibility, we will have to see. Every teacher is supposed to have what is his responsibility. In such a dark season, what the teachers are doing, college teacher has got a more responsibility. Let us see and explore the possibility how we can reach to the unreached people and how we can support the labor. And migrant labor is a major problem. I won't take much more of the time on this one. But in present context, in higher education, there is need to promote innovation and entrepreneurship. At the same time, why to have a ranking at national level? Why not an international level? In case if we have got something in our hand, if you want to say that we are really, as far as the quality assurance is concerned, we are responsible, we have made a lot of reforms, then kindly prove at international level. Many times I have seen a lot of universities are working. Out of 1,000 university, I'm sorry to say, not a single university is getting a space in one first 200 university across the world, 250 university across the world. So that's why we will have to say, find out a way out and way forward for getting an international ranking. Industries, academia interface is one of the promising option. Global collaboration, in case if we have an international ranking, definitely we will explore the possibility of collaboration and cooperation globally. Even alumnia, we will have to involve the alumnia that is perhaps is missing in a present system of education. And we will have a technology enabled learning. So there are a lot of issues is there, but thank you very much. I have already taken more time, but I am really happy that to a certain extent I have tried to give that what was ancient during the medieval period, what was the scenario of education, what is our present scenario, and then how we will go for a quick learning and force entrepreneurship in year to come, and how digital technology will play important role. So there are a lot of things is there. We will not stop our education system because of corona, but perhaps it is a type of experience. And whatever experience so far have we got in our lockdown period, we will try to use this experience in present experiment, and we will fulfill the expectation of all stakeholder in near future. That is a perhaps way out in present context. But thank you very much, Dikshita Madam. You have given me this opportunity, and I have seen a lot of senior colleagues have also joined, and some youngsters have also joined. To a certain extent, I have justified my talk. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot, Madam.
Ji, thanks, sir. Thanks, sir. I hereby convey my sincere thanks to Honorable VC Dr. Rathod, sir, for sharing his valuable views and thoughts प्रोफेसर गिरीशनाथ माथुर सर भी हमारे साथ ही जुड़े थे. मैं थैंक्स कर रही हूँ. और जैसा कि हमें कमेंट्स से ही पता चल रहा है कि आई एम डैम श्योर ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स वुड हैव गेन नॉलेज इन वेरियस एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ द टॉपिक एजुकेशन पास्ट प्रेजेंट एंड फ्यूचर. एट दिस मोमेंट आई ऑल्सो कन्वे माई सिंसियर थैंक्स टू ऑनरेबल वीसी प्रोफेसर भगवती प्रसाद शर्मा, डीन डॉक्टर नीति राणा मैम, एचओडी डॉक्टर विनोद शानवाल सर. I also thank all the participants for this active listening and participation. Thanks, sir. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you.